Welcome, everyone. My name is David Van Zandt. I'm the president here at the New School. It's my great pleasure to have you here for this event. And in particular, I want to thank a couple of people for joining us tonight. Ambassador Sasha Lorente Saliz, Bolivia's permanent representative to the UN. Welcome back. Where is he?
I'm here.
Oh, there. Sorry, right up there. Good, good, good. You're speaking. I don't think Pablo Gentile is with us yet.
No.
Okay. And then also I'd like to recognize Pavlina Strasburg, the political affairs attaché for Mexico here in New York. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. Tonight we celebrate the President Nestor Kirchner Fellowship Program. It was established to honor the legacy of the former president of Argentina. We are completing our sixth year of the fellowship. The fellowship has been made possible in part by the generous support of the late Julian Studley. Julian was a New School trustee and a very faithful supporter of the Observatory on Latin America. And you know, we do miss him. He passed away this past year. I'd also like to thank the Universidad Nacional de San Martin for also supporting the fellowship. Finally, it's my great pleasure to announce again, because I had this opportunity to do it in Buenos Aires, but it's my great pleasure to be able to announce the winners of the Kirchner Fellowship. We're going to hear from two of them tonight who are with us and spending some time here at the New School. The first is Sergio Miranda Hayes from Bolivia. Good to have you. Congratulations. And then Isabella Esquivel Aventura from Mexico. Good to have you with us. Oh, and I should also recognize your mother, who's here to support you. So, then in February of this coming year, we will welcome the other two winners of the Kirchner Fellowship, Javier Perez Ibanez from Argentina, and Bianca Moura de Calvaro from Brazil. This is the first year, in fact, that we've had a winner from Bolivia. So that is tremendous. That's really tremendous. And it's also the second year we've had a winner from Mexico. So it's great. It's great to be able to have another Mexican here. We expanded the fellowship a year ago, to include Central and North America. So over the years, we've had five fellows from Brazil. And then each year of the fellowship, we've had a fellow from Argentina. We've had in total over 20 fellows. We've had 20 fellows in the 6 years of the life of the fellowship. Again, it was my great pleasure each of those times to be down in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, to be on the final jury selecting them. And I must say, every year, we'd have a new crop. And they were even more spectacular than the prior year. We won't tell the first fellows that, but they've really gotten better and better. They're tremendous. So now let me turn over the podium to Margot Gutman, Professor Margot Gutman here at the New School, to explain the process as well as to introduce the ambassador. Margot.
Thank you, David. I will tell you a little bit about the fellowship, and particularly, we think that it is a particular relevant moment in our Latin American countries, that after a decade of progressive governments, we are now being challenged in different ways and in different countries. I will give you some information about how we got to select every year for young leaders from Latin America. It's a complicated process because we are expecting the fellows to have an academic career, but at the same time, a social and political commitment. This is not that we were looking only for excellence in the academy, but also we are looking about a strong commitment to social justice through works in the government, in civil society organizations, or in other parts of institutions in which these young leaders can exercise the best of what they have learned and they are building as knowledge, and the best of their commitment to social justice. Then, the process is a little complicated. Bear with me, I will explain it. It is a three-round process. This year, we received 100 applications with candidates from 13 countries of all Latin America, as David Van Sant explained. And the selection process is done, had been designed specially by a specialist in evaluation in Buenos Aires, a professor that unfortunately passed away a couple of years ago. Then when we receive the 100 applications, there is an initial round of on-site jury of 10 or 11 academics and officials that met at the Universidad Nacional de San Martín in Buenos Aires, and they met in June 2016. This group select half of the applications and send this half of the applications to a jury of 30 Latin American jurors distributed in all Latin America that analyze each of the presentations, and they come up with a selection of approximately 20 applicants. And these 20 applicants, after having an interview with professors at the new school to see if they can express and talk fluently in English, they pass to the third jury, in which President Van Sant comes every year for the sixth year to Buenos Aires and join with other juries. They sit down a whole morning and sometimes part of the afternoon to select the four winners, the four awarded fellows, after complicated deliberations. And in this year, among the 10 members of this meeting, on-site meeting, it was the Daniel Di Gregorio, the vice rector of the Universidad Nacional de San Martín. This time Ruta couldn't come, the rector, because he was traveling. We had also Cecilia Naon, who was a former Argentine ambassador to the US and now professor at the American University in Washington. Patricia Baca Narvaja, from the former Argentine ambassador to Mexico. Mercedes Marco del Pont, who was the former governor of the Central Bank of Argentina and now director of the productivity unit in the Universidad Nacional de San Martín. And also Rubén Ramírez, director of CAF, the Andean Development Bank in Argentina. After long deliberations, this difficult. It was comparing, you know, pears with roses. It was very difficult to do it, but up to now the result is excellent. All the 18, because we know 18, we don't know the other two that they are coming in February, March. They were excellent. Young leaders that we think that each of them in their own kind of field has an enormous potential to go ahead with their research and with their social justice activities. Now, it's now my great pleasure to introduce Ambassador Sasha Lorenti Solis, who is the Bolivian permanent representative to the United Nations. Sasha is a lawyer and a university professor. He was president of the Permanent Assembly of Human Rights in Bolivia and was minister of government in the Democratic Cultural Revolution in Bolivia. At the UN, he was the chair of the Group of 77 plus China, an organized the G77 summit in Bolivia in 2014. Ambassador Lorenti is the author of many books, among others, and I am translating the title, The Kidnapped Truth, Private Media and the Process of Change in Bolivia, which was published in 2012. Now, please join us to give a warm welcome to Ambassador Sasha Lorenti, who will introduce our Kirchner Fellow from Bolivia, Sergio Miranda Hayes.
Good evening to you all. Thank you very, very much for this kind invitation. It is a real honor for me to be here. Let me please thank at the outset the president of the New School and also the Observatory on Latin America. It is the third time that I'm joining you in some of your activities, and it is really an, as I said, an honor, and it's really encouraging to see that Latin America is being seen from different perspective, not just one here in the United States. I have to say that I spent the last 4 years here in New York, so maybe I'm not the most appropriate one to talk about what's happening right now in Latin America. But it is really an honor for me to introduce Sergio Miranda. As you've heard, he's the first Bolivian to be awarded with this scholarship. Not just because for what it represents for him, but also for the country, and the way this this scholarship is trying to encourage Latin American, not just activists, but also to encourage their academic goals from a social perspective. It was intended for me as an honor because when I hear the name of Nestor Kirchner, I have very strong feelings because I had the honor to meet him in different capacities when he was president of Argentina. I was at that time working closely with President Morales in my country, and I was a firsthand witness of the solidarity of Nestor Kirchner when Bolivia was going through very, very difficult times. In 2007 and 2008, there were attempts of coup d'etats, and small groups were trying to divide the country, and we were very, very close to a civil war, really. And it was because of the solidarity of what was happening at that time in Latin America that we managed to save that process and to continue deepening the Bolivian revolution. I also met Nestor Kirchner when he was Secretary General of UNASUR. I remember the last one of the last meetings that he held. It was during the attempt coup d'etat again against Rafael Correa from Ecuador. He called an emergency meeting in Buenos Aires, and I had the honor again to go with President Morales to this meeting. But the time that when I had the possibility to have a relationship, but to see him closer, was when there was an attempt in Colombia to rescue some of the people who were kidnapped in by the FARC in Colombia. So there was a multinational team that was built up at that time. Under the leadership of President Hugo Chavez, and he was the head of the Argentinian delegation that went to Colombia at that time, and I was the head of the Bolivian delegation. So for me, that was an opportunity to work closely with him. So I can say that the fact that this scholarship has his name is very, very important, because we are not talking about any normal individual, but one of the most important leaders of the recent history of my region, from Latin America. I was trying to get closer to Sergio's work, and you will hear from him, but I want to just make a couple of comments regarding one of its main contributions, which is the study of the recognition of the Bolivian constitution of indigenous right and what's called legal pluralism. I think this is very important, because when we have an Eurocentric way of seeing the world, we might be blind to different perspectives in order to solve some problems, not just recognizing what different cultures do. In the case of Bolivia, what we should ask is, what happened? I mean, when you have a country with almost two-thirds of the population is indigenous, why it took so long to recognize this system? Why it took so long to have the first indigenous president in the country where, I think, as I said, you have two-thirds of the population of indigenous people? I think those things are very important to ask ourselves, because they have to do with, as I said, this Eurocentric way of looking at things, of solving our problems. And Bolivia right now is facing a deep process of economic, political, and social transformation. Sergio is going to talk about one of those phases, one of those issues. I just want to mention a couple of things that are happening right now in Bolivia. I'm talking about very deep economical changes. That's why it is a revolution, because we are changing the structures of how the system is being run. 10 years ago, I'm sure that you're aware that the most important export good that Bolivia has is gas. And 10 years ago, the relationship between the state and the oil companies was the following. The oil companies would get 82% of the whole revenue, 82%, and the state will get just 18%. And these big oil companies, I can mention a few, would not just have that amount of the revenue, but also will have complete control of our natural resources from down earth all the way to the commercialization and production and commercialization. Whenever Morales got into power, as I said, the first indigenous president in an indigenous country, he changed all those things around. So now, the Bolivian state, the Bolivian people, through the state, gets 82% of the revenue, and the companies, the international companies, get 18%. And even with that change, you know, that radical change of the terms of our relationship with these companies, they stayed in the country because they were still making money. They stayed in the country, most of them. And that really was one of the ways in which we can explain what's happening in Bolivia. Bolivia is maybe the country, there's a competition with another country, but Bolivia might be the first or the second country that's reducing poverty the most. We have reduced extreme poverty from around 45% to 15% in 10 years. In 10 years. Our plan is that for 2025, we will eradicate extreme poverty in Bolivia. And things are going on that direction. Bolivia is the country that has reduced inequality like no other in the Western world, the Western hemisphere, like no other. If you see, for example, regarding women's rights, you see which is the the second country that has most women, more women in parliament, that's Bolivia. We have like 54-55% of women right now in parliament. So, and if you see every single social index, you will see how much Bolivia has improved because of those kinds of decisions. So, when we as Sergio is pointing out, when we look at a pluralistic system, we have to look at also different ways to solve our problems. Besides this indigenous rights recognition system of recognition, Bolivia is also trying to build up their own model for not just growth but for development. We call it living well. I think I don't have time to explain all of it, but it is a proposal that really wants to build up an option in comparison to capitalism, to try to build an economy and a society with different values than capitalism. It is a hard, of course, it's a difficult way to go, but I think we are on the right path. Just allow me to say, before I finish, a couple of things about Sergio. Sergio Miranda holds a master's degree in governance and human rights from the Autonomous University of Madrid, and a master's in law from the Central European University in Budapest. He has worked in the Constitutional Court of Bolivia and with the University of San Francisco Xavier in Bolivia, which is in the capital of Bolivia. He currently works as a pro bono lawyer for indigenous organization. And he will be the one who will talk more about his work. Allow me again just to thank Ola for for opening these windows of possibilities to students from Latin America. And let me know that you can count on us for whatever you want. Thank you very much.
I want to thank first to all the authorities, professors, colleagues, students who made this possible. I am deeply thankful to the ambassador of Bolivia because of his marvelous words. He actually said many important things and truth about my country. I am very happy to be here. I'm very happy to be in this wonderful city. One thing that surprised me the most by coming here was the huge and vast diversity that New York has. I really liked that fact, but I thought about what happens in other regions, what happens in other countries. And one thing that is very important to remark is the fact that many countries are made by diversity. That happens in Latin America. As the ambassador said, we have a great percentage of indigenous populations in our countries. And I took three countries which are kind of the most representative countries that recognize indigenous rights. First is Bolivia, then Ecuador, and then Colombia. And their indigenous populations are really vast. For example, in Bolivia, more than the 40% of the population is indigenous, and as you know, our president is indigenous too. In Ecuador is the 10% of the indigenous population, and in Colombia is the 6%. However, this population of indigenous people mark a starting point for the constitutional systems. And I have to note here that these last years of advancement toward the recognition of indigenous rights are just one small period of time compared to what the indigenous have felt and are feeling now by their suffering and by their domination. So, what did the state do in order to protect these indigenous rights? I have to note one important fact, that is the ratification of the International Labor Convention. And by here, I want to say that the right to self-determination was one of the biggest points in that international instrument. The right to self-determination traduced in other rights. Now, for example, the legal pluralism that is recognized in both in all three countries that I studied is made from the starting point of the right of self-determination. And by this, I am saying that they are acknowledging what they are, who they are. They are acknowledging their history. They are acknowledging their horrible past. And by this, they are shaping also the constitutional system, which is the important part in my study. The Constitution of Colombia, which was enacted in 1991, guarantees the right to cultural diversity and proclaims the equality of cultures. By this, Colombia was shaping its constitutional identity. So this plurality of cultures is going to make all the decisions within the constitutional system. So every decision in Colombia will take into account this plurality of cultures. And by this, we're taking into account the right to self-determination of the cultures, because the cultures will shape also constitutional law. And the constitutions of Ecuador and Bolivia, which one was enacted in 2008 and the other 2009, are also going to recognize that, but they are going to go a bit farther, because they are proclaiming themselves as plurinational, which is the recognition not only of the coexistence of many jurisdictions within a sovereign territory, but also they are proclaiming themselves as decolonizing and anti-capitalists, because of the nature of their societies, because of the nature of the presence of indigenous communities there. What is that decolonization that they are claiming? Well, it is a retrieval of their own institutions against the trend of the hegemonic governance of the Western culture. And by saying that, they are recognizing even that they have to break again from a new colonization. What is this new colonization? In the words of many scholars, for example, Gross Fogel or Adolfo Quijano, is the break of the academic colonization and the economic colonization. And this now is traduced in our constitutional system. For example, the Constitution of Ecuador says in its preamble, "We are the heirs of the victory against colonization." Can you imagine that and compare it to the United States Constitution? Because it starts with "we the people." It's a very strong statement. The same happens in the Constitution of Bolivia, which in many articles, the Bolivian Constitution claims that victory against colonization. And in the case law in Colombia, although in its constitution it's not recognized this decolonization process, in the case law, the Constitutional Court also noted that. So now a very important thing to remark about my investigation is the model of a state. Both Bolivia and Ecuador claim themselves as plurinational, and this fact will shape all the decisions of the Constitutional Court and will shape also the sentences about individual claims that are brought to the constitutional system. And what happens in Colombia is that Colombian case law claim itself as a pluralistic state. So what's the difference between both of them? Well, the difference between both of them is a matter of hierarchy. For example, Ecuador and Bolivia take into account the hierarchy of indigenous law as at the equal level of ordinary law. This is a very important fact to remark, because this is going to shape all the model of states, and this is why it is called plurinational, among other issues that I will note here. The Bolivian, the Colombian constitutional system, it's a bit different, because the indigenous system of Colombia is under the ordinary laws of the state, in contrast to Ecuador and Bolivia. And there are other issues that arise after this model of state naming. For example, the plurinational states have their own plurinational institutions. For example, in Bolivia, we have Congress and other instances that are called themselves as plurinational. For example, we have the Plurinational Assembly, which is now the Congress. We have the Plurinational Constitutional Court, which has its own particularities. For example, now in the Constitutional Court in Bolivia, we have a permanent technical secretariat of decolonization, which is made by sociologists, anthropologists, and amautas. These amautas are only indigenous authorities. So if you have, you want to apply to the position, you have to be an indigenous authority or have been an indigenous authority. And this is a particularity about the Constitutional Court of Bolivia. And Colombia and Ecuador have this kind of organization, but is not a permanent organization. So, but Ecuador's scholars recognize the fact that they have to institute a plurinational constitutional courts. Other issue that I have to note about the plurinational states is that they have the different moral principles than normal, let's say, regular states. For example, the Constitution of Bolivia claims moral principles, indigenous moral principles. So now it's a bit of a syncretism between the indigenous law, indigenous traditions, and the ordinary tradition, let's say, the Western tradition. So in our constitution, we have many important things to note. For example, we have the Summa Camaña, which is the good life. We have the Ñan Dereco, which is the harmonious life. We have the Tecohabi, which is the good life, which are principles that have to shape all constitutional decisions. And I have to give an example here. Back then in 2014, there was an issue about the constitutionality of abortion. And a congresswoman brought that claim to the Constitutional Court. And the Constitutional Court solved this issue on the grounds of these moral principles of the Constitution. And the judges from the Constitutional Court held that the criminalization of on abortion was constitutional, arguing moral principles of indigenous communities. So the criminalization of abortion is still constitutional, so it is a very important issue that I have to note. And this is an example that gives us a wider picture about why it is called plurinational state. So by these denominations, there are some rights born. And this is a very important fact, because the activists of human rights and the people who advocate in favor of human rights are always thinking about a better protection for the people. So now indigenous communities have more rights. For example, by the starting point of the International Labor Convention, district countries recognized that the communal lands of ethnic groups are inalienable and imprescriptible. So this is a powerful statement, because land of the indigenous people can't be touched by the state if they don't go through specific measures. For example, now they have to consult the indigenous communities in any measure taking that affects them. And the same happens in Bolivia, the same happens in Ecuador, but Bolivia as a plurinational country is constitutionally obliged to grant indigenous land to them who don't have the land. So this is a very good advancement because the state of Bolivia is obliged constitutionally to grant land rights to indigenous communities that do not have land. And this is very important because this is a clear fact of a fight against social injustice. So there are many issues raised from the starting point of natural resources. And one is the conflict with non-renewable resources. You know that in Latin America, most countries have the original domain over non-renewable resources. So if, for example, in my house, I find oil in the soil, yeah, it's not going to be mine. It is from the state. So the issue here is what happens if one indigenous community finds oil or some resources which is non-renewable in its territory. So every indigenous community in all three countries that I mentioned have the right to prior consultation. So they have to be consulted about any measure taken by the state in its territory. This happens in those three countries, and this is a very important thing to remark because it is very important for indigenous people, their land, and the case law of the Colombian Constitutional Court, the case law of Ecuadorian and also the Bolivian Constitutional Court said that indigenous people are linked to their land. And the survival of these indigenous communities depends on the right that they have on their lands. So if one state is going to affect or restrict one land rights of the indigenous community, is attempting against their lives. And this is what the case law from all three countries said. This is very interesting. And we have one very interesting provision about territory also in the Ecuadorian constitution, which I found the most interesting. This is about the ancestral territory. So this article 57 is forbidding all forms of extraction of ancestral territories. What are the ancestral territories? Are territories that are owned by people who live in voluntary isolation, and these measures, for example, if the government is trying to extract these resources, are punished and condemned as ethnocide. The constitution says so, and this is a very powerful provision, which is very protective towards the indigenous communities. Other issue that I have to take into account, and I have to remember you that my investigation is about comparative law, and in comparative law we use some elements to try to bring the best and the worst of our study. So here I found very interesting things about the rights of indigenous people in the linguistic and educational grounds. For example, the Colombian Constitution recognized the ethno-cultural education, which is a very important thing because they do a system of education that is made by indigenous people, for indigenous people, and with indigenous traditions and customs. The same happens in Ecuador, the same happens in Bolivia, and we had many advancements in that area. In Ecuador and in Bolivia, we have the indigenous universities that are educating indigenous all over our territories. This is a very important thing because by this, we are protecting the survival of the culture themselves. because educating the indigenous using their own traditions is protecting them also not to be diluted in with the Western culture, let's say. And the same happens in the institutions of Bolivia, and this is a very important thing to note. To reach the conclusions of my research, I want to say that legal pluralism and indigenous rights have become one of the cornerstones of these states. The recognition of plurality, the recognition about a multiplicity of life forms within a territory have shaped all the constitutional identity of our countries. And this is very important because, as I said, constitutional judgments are now obliged to follow this particular fact. I have also to note that the ILO Convention 169 have brought many advancements to our countries, and it also shaped the own identity of these countries, and now we are developing our own identity on the grounds of the indigenous rights. It happened a constitutional syncretism. As I said, the plurinational country is a very broad theme, and the important fact of this is that indigenous customs are being now taken into account in all judicial decisions. I have also to conclude that linguistic and educational rights are very important. As I said, the educational rights have a very important meaning because the practice of these rights secure the survival of the indigenous communities, and that the new model of state are an effort of governments to gain social inclusion. And by this gaining of social inclusion, I want to end this intervention by recalling important words of a wise man who struggled against social injustice. And by this, I want to recall the words of Nestor Kirchner when he was just a congressman. I think he didn't have the idea that he was going to be a president. Argentina was facing one of its worst crises, and he said, "I won't give up on the principles of my nation. I won't give up on the objectives of my nations, nor in the values of my nations, and I won't sit on my couch while my nation is tearing apart." And this is very important because indigenous communities were taken apart, were subjugated, were dominated, and they were always struggling. They are struggling right now. There are many things to do. And I want to recall this phrase also because of last week's results. I watched many things. I saw many people disappointed. But I want to tell all of you, please don't give up. Don't give up on the principles of your nation. Don't give up on your values. The struggle is always pending. We have to struggle day by day. Thank you very much.
Sergio, very much. Sergio, thank you, Ambassador, and thank you, Sergio, for recalling the memory of President Nestor Kirchner, in which honor has been established this fellowship. I would like to invite to the podium to Paulina Strasburger, who is the cultural attaché of the Consulate of Mexico in New York, to introduce Isabella.
Hi, good night, everyone. First, I would like to thank the New School and the Observatory in Latin America for inviting me tonight. It is a pleasure to be here to witness Isabella's work. I think tonight's about Isabella, so let me talk about her like a little bit. Isabella holds a BA in International Relations from the National Autonomous University of Mexico and a Master in Public Policy and Gender from the Latin American Social Science School. She graduated with honors in both degrees. Her academic background proves diverse, as she has completed specialized studies on gender equality and environmental education in global-oriented institutions, such as the United Nations University for Peace, the Ibero-American University Foundation, and the International Institute for Learning. She currently works as the executive director of organizational architecture in the government of Mexico, where she has taken on the task to promote the adoption and implementation of gender-responsive and gender-inclusive public policies at a city level. She has experienced firsthand the challenges brought by the efforts of mainstreaming gender equalities in public policies. Her efforts, however, do not go without challenging policy practice. In both her academic research and public sector work, Isabella focused on the urgency to understand gender, violence, and violence against women by reflecting on the predominant conceptual frameworks and configurations shaping policy constructs. With the work she's presenting here tonight, titled Preventing Violence Against Women in Mexico City, Isabella shares an analysis and also invites us to reflect on the theoretical and methodological approaches influencing gender issues in Mexico, and most importantly, those shaping the way violence is understood, thus identified. In this sense, hers is a call for reflecting about violence and women in the context of the construction of masculine identity in Mexico. Stemming for the incorporation of the masculinities approach, Isabella suggests that preventing violence against women will not only derive from fostering women's participation, but needs the positive engaging of men in such prevention. The debate to which she invites us opens the door for a deeper and more critical analysis of an issue that we undoubtedly need to explore. So thank you, Isabella. We are very proud of you.
Hello, good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for your welcome and also for the introduction. I am really happy to be here, and I am really pleased to the opportunity that President Nestor Kirchner Fellowship gave to us to present and to share our advances in our countries and also our findings in our professional experiences. So I thank you, everybody, for being here. And as you have heard before, the topic of my presentation is about preventing masculine violence against women in Mexico City. And let me please compliment the introduction that Paulina gave about me. And the topic also of the conference is fighting for social justice. And I have to say that in a professional and in a personal way, I have been trying to be committed with social justice in my country and in every field that I have any impact. So this presentation is the result and is a synthesis of my master's degree thesis that was about the same topic, and that resulted from the opportunity of thinking about what is the violence problem in my country. I have to know that while I was developing the research, I was working in the Mexican government in the public safety sector, and in a very interesting moment, that it was the elaboration of national development plan, and in specific in the public safety sector, as I said. So what I was thinking about violence in Mexico is that something was missing when I looked about the types of violence that were being addressed by the public interventions. I realized that all those violence are considered separately, that they have different causes. But I was thinking about that because when studying gender-based violence, I thought that it was something that those violence share, that those violence had in common. And What I am presenting right now is that those violence have in common that they comes from a gender perspective and from a gender notion of violence that are related to masculinities. And I will explain in a few minutes about that. So as I said, my commitment is not only in the academic research and teaching, but also as a public servant in my country, and also, and recently, more related with social engagement. So this combination gave me the opportunity to work on gender equality for social justice. Well, what is the problem about gender-based violence in Mexico? One of the issues I had to face during the research was that information about gender-based violence is very recent, but because we didn't have enough information before, we didn't measure that problem before with a strong methodology. But in the recent years, we already have some data about that. And violence against women is measured in the country as almost 50% of women have suffered any kind of violence from their partners. And it's a specific data that we found. And in specific in Mexico City, that is the city on which is focused the research, more than 25% of women have suffered violence from their partners. So it seems that it's not a big problem, but that's what the data say. But it's a bigger problem that we face in Mexico, and not only in Mexico, but in many other countries. But what happened when I was thinking about that, okay, we have now information about women that have suffered any kind of violence, but who exercised this violence? In this data, they show us that their partners exercise this violence, and I was looking for something that can prove the same information, but gathered from the men's experience. And I found only one survey that was talking about that, and it was a regional survey in Latin America. And it says that for the Mexican case, the 17% of men declared to exercise physical violence against their partner. 3% declared that they exercise sexual violence against their partner, and 1% against other people. So the information do not fit very well, because we don't find that we have the same proportion about who is a victim, overall women, victims of violence, and those men who exercise violence. And this is the first obstacle that I found in the research. So, but with this information, the research was a qualitative policy analysis, and it is a characteristic not only of the research, but also about the master's degree program, because it is on public policy and gender. And for that link between policy, public policy and gender give us the challenge to take the feminist movements it's from, and the gender studies that is from where this analysis comes, to translate this into public intervention. So it's not only a political statement, but also it's a technical challenge. And for that, it was a case study about Mexico City and its public policy oriented to prevent gender-based violence. And in a period of time, because of the time I was developing this research, the period of time was from 2007 and 2013. So these characteristics of the research gave some limitations also, that it is not a social research, so it's not a theoretical purpose for this analysis. And while being a case study, it is not a comparative study. It doesn't consider to compare situations or to compare public interventions among other cities or other countries with Mexico City case. So it is also a limitation about the public policy context, that because public policy can be constituted by many, many elements that comes from policies in general, coming from law or coming from other instruments, planning instruments, but also can be programs or can be specific activities about solving the public problem. And that it's a very difficult opportunity to identify what is the limits of that public policy. So it is also focused on the design of public policy. So it doesn't go to an implementation or evaluation analysis. So it's only about the design. And also in a conceptual framework, it is also a limitation about gender, because gender studies talks about many other elements and dimensions than being a woman or being a man. It talks about transgender and queer studies and other dimensions of gender equality. But this is focused only in the construction, in the social construction of femininity and masculinity. So maybe it's a very limited analysis, but that limitations also gave me an opportunity to find specific recommendations that can serve to any other context, as I will explain. So the main question of the research was how much the masculinity studies from gender perspective have been incorporated in violence against women prevention policies in Mexico City. So the hypothesis about that is that policies in terms of prevention have a more reactive perspective than preventive, because it has only a punitive character for aggressors. So it was maybe a stereotype about how do we see in our social imaginary the problem on gender-based violence against women. And for that, the objective of the research was to explain the importance of including working with men for the transformation of the structural causes of the problem, and to have a policy improvement. So about the information sources, well, the information is very diverse, and so I had to take into account the legal framework, programs and policy documents, requests of information, because not all information is available for public consultation, and also interviews, surveys or studies existing in the field. And what I did was a methodology that in social sciences is very useful, because it is named operationalization, that is to take those theoretical concepts and try to translate them into a measurable dimensions that can that lead us to a public policy analysis. So it has to be an independent variable, and dependent variable that when comparing between them, we can find a specific analysis that can lead to a public policy recommendations. So the conceptual framework is the most maybe controversial issue, because this research let me see that it is not easy to analyze gender-based violence. It's a very complex social phenomenon, so gender studies has many vectors or many lines that one or the most common is the women's studies, but in the other hand we have masculinities and men's studies. So with that, that the vectors of gender studies give us the opportunity to understand that our social divisions based on sexual difference can become into a gender division and hierarchy. And if we continue to reproducing this division and this hierarchy can lead us into an inequality, discrimination, and violence situations. So it is a very complex to explain the link among them because they're not in a line. It is not progressive like that, but in some situation it is. And well, this men and masculinities studies talk about masculinity is a social configuration. It's a social construction around the idea of being a man in a certain society. But the elements that are related with that social configuration is there's a lot of them, but their power, hierarchy, hegemony, domination, and control. That's what masculinity or an hegemonic masculinity model talk about. They talk about having, exercising, and reproducing power, domination, control, hierarchy, and hegemony. So with this, we have those elements that combine can give us different types of masculinities. That is an important clue that gender study give us, because sometimes we think that masculinity is a synonym of men, but they are not. They are different. Men are persons, are people, are in the individual way, or also in the collective, in the collectivity, but masculinity is a model. Masculinity is an idea around being a man, and for that they're not the same. And for that, the combination of these elements give us different ways to be a man in different societies or even in the same society. So it is an important contribution from gender studies. And a specific analysis about that is what the director of my thesis research proposed about structural access, and he said that masculinities and their configurations have access that depending on the importance the role they have in the masculinity configuration, they are hard to change or most likely to change. And violence, it's a mechanism to reproduce, maintain, and exercise power, for example, domination, control, and the other elements of masculinity. So it is very hard to change these structural acts, but it's not impossible. But with these considerations, violence could be considered as masculine. It means that violence is exercised in masculine terms, and as I pointed out before, it is not because we are blaming men or we consider that men have to exercise violence in every sense and in the whole, but that we have to recognize that it is a mechanism of being a man in a social construction. So, but there are a lot of vectors that of exercising violence. That one of them is violence among men that can consider even war, armed conflicts, gangs violence, or even the state violence. So it is a really interesting analysis about seeing violence not only who is exercised from men to women, but also that violence that is exercised among men in the name of their masculinities. With that, we also have, of course, in this analysis that violence can be exercised against women, but also against other people that do not fit the hegemonic masculinity, such as girls and boys, the elder persons, LGBTTI persons or community, persons with disabilities, the ethnicity analysis, or even against the environment. This is a very deep reflection on that, but it's a proposal also. And finally, another vector of this masculine violence is that is exercised against themselves, against in the individual, against men. That can affect their health care, that can lead men into risk situations, and that can finalize in the extreme in suicides. So the implications of masculine violence in this perspective is subordination, oppression, human rights violations, social injustice, and of course homicides, femicides, and other hate crimes. So for this, the proposal here is to try to reflect about violence in masculine terms, and that can be disaggregated into another concepts in order to focus from who it is exercised and to whom it is exercised. And for this research, the final concept that I used, it was masculine gender-based violence against women, and it is a really, really specific concept that comes from this analysis. The analysis and findings gave me the opportunity to compare one concept about masculine violence that are that comes from the beliefs, the social mandates, and behaviors of exercising that violence, and if public policy fit with the attention of this problem. And what I found is that they do not fit with the problem, because the elements and the characteristics of the public policy to prevent gender-based violence in Mexico City are that the target population are women, and the most part are women. That's very important, that's a very urgent topic, and that's necessary. It is not a critique, it's only to say that it's not enough, because the perspective, of course, is respecting women human rights, but men and masculinities are not considered into account to change these violent relationships among men and women. So something is missing since the diagnostics, because men are mostly considered as only aggressors. They do not, these perspectives cannot let us try to change that masculinity's construction that are based on violence. So the intervention characteristics are focused on men and our majority in the majority programs and our activities. It means that we don't have the highest level of public policy to prevent gender-based violence, and also we don't have it to prevent since a structural change as working with men and their masculinities. And it comes in the conceptual framework that is used in this public policy, that it's violence against women. It do not even consider that it's gender-based violence. It's only violence against women. And as I said, men and masculinity are not systematically immersed. I mean, they participate in some activities for preventing violence against women, but not in an structural way. So about the social problem, the conclusion is that there is enough evidence about masculine violence as a social problem. We don't have, maybe it is not enough to have a complete diagnostic about that, but it is enough to realize that it is a big problem and that we have to do something with that since the public interventions. There is also an academic production about gender issues, violence and masculinity, so we don't have to find any other theoretical framework. We can complete with another framework, but we have a base about that. And we have important experiences about working with men overall coming from civil society. So we have only to collaborate to have the best experiences to translate this into public interventions. And about public policy, there is a legal framework that also it is not enough to say that working with men is an issue considered since the legal framework, but it's not a limitant to do it. The mainstreaming and institutionalization obstacles are big because in a technical way, they're big for gender equality in general, not only for working with men, but the previous efforts are isolated, so we have to take it into account to systematize that. And the institutional challenges are that we have to introduce a perspective, this conceptual framework. We have to reconceptualize the policies, programs, projects, and activities, and it is a big challenge. And for that, this conclusion led to the hypothesis confirmation that the public policy is not considering working with men to transform in a structural way gender-based violence. The policy recommendations at the end were in a lot of levels. The specific is that we need more training and updating for the personnel working on preventing gender-based violence. We have to put the issue into the public agenda. It is a big challenge too, but we have to start with that. We have to consider the public policy cycle, not only design, and not only the evaluation, not only implementation. We have to consider it as a whole, the cycle. And we have to strengthen the institutional level. It means to consider the contribution of other actors or the intersection of responsibilities with other programs that exist in other public institutions. And also the recommendations from civil society that they have a lot of experience on that. And this is a work that do not finish here. Maybe for the research purposes, it finished here with the recommendations. But to be consistent with the recommendations I found and I proposed to the authorities that wrote that, is that looking forward, we have to start with working in the public agenda, and for that, at least many of my colleagues and I, we are working on that. We are trying to propose a public agenda that considers working with men for gender equality, not only in the national level, but also in the local level. We have some experience that are starting. We have to apply in other contexts. Maybe the international system would be an important context to apply this analysis, and also the United States experience, considering the context that you are facing right now. And I think that it is an invitation to start that reflection that many other problems that we are facing around the world and in the country context can be analyzed since a gender perspective through masculinity's lens, because every problem that we are facing right now have something to do with power, hierarchy, control, domination, and all those elements that are considered for the hegemonic masculinity. So the challenge is that we have to lead to transformative changes, and not only public interventions that contents or only reduce in some way the problem, but we have to do something else to have more transformative changes and to finish with that social problems. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Isabella. We now have a little bit of time for some questions. So if people would have questions.
Perhaps you will invite Paulina to
there. Oh, yeah. Paulina, would you like to?
No, or that final?
No,
because you can share the conversation.
Sure, please, come on. Sure, please.
Thank you.
Okay, great. You want to pose your question?
What do you think? Oh, sorry. Hi. Hi, I'm Lizzie with the Schiller Institute. I'd like to ask you what you think about the concept of the New Silk Road, in which there could be a potential collaboration between the US, Russia, China, and South America in developing the world by collaborating on huge development projects, and in that way, actually, ending world poverty internationally. Through all these development projects. Now, Peru is right now, having this great collaboration with China, specifically on the railway. And through this, the New Silk Road, that just creates a whole new potential for mankind for collaboration. So I'd like to know what you think about that as an alternative to the current, geopolitical paradigm, which is basically dying. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I think maybe we'll collect a few questions. First, let's see. Please, okay, over here. Great. Thank you, Luis.
I wanted to direct this question to the ambassador and to Mr. Miranda. In terms of going back to what you said in your presentation, mentioning that the Constitution of Bolivia has sort of taken that responsibility that it will implement a prior and informed consent before extracting any natural resources of the land. I was wondering if you could both touch briefly on what happened last year when the president gave the go for the oil exploration in the Tibnis region, and if you could explain if that sort of interfered with some indigenous groups that were actually revolting against that intervention.
Okay. Other questions? Other questions, comment? Marcus? Over here.
Okay, thanks so much. Both presentations were absolutely brilliant. Joy to be here. huge transformations in terms of the constitutions in Latin America. My question is about the plurinational aspects. It is about categories versus fluidity. There is some critique by people like Kuzikanki that like in things like the census, you have to cross a box. What identity are you in? So there is a certain number of indigenous identities, and that was criticized as, a new kind of an iron cage. So on one level, we have this huge advance of the new type of constitutions, but on that level, it looks like as if a new type of problems come up. Do you see that? What are the solutions to it? In that tension between categories and fluidity.
Thank you. Okay, let's just take one more question and then we can, sure, back in the back here.
Hi, my question is for Isabella. Why do you focus on Mexico City feminist crisis when it's in the whole country?
Okay, that's a good question. Okay, so we have an interesting set of first round of questions. Who would like to?
Maybe then.
Sergio, you want to start?
Yes, of
sure,
course.
Sure.
Well, thank you very much for the questions. I want to answer the question about the Tipnis, which is a very important region in my country. This was a very important issue also at the constitutional level because rights were involved there. However, I must say that every government in the world has its successes and its things that have to grow through. I think the involvement of a road that had to be built in one particular community had also a lot to do with consultations toward the indigenous communities, but not only to one particular sector, but also to a broader sector that was also involved. So I think all Bolivian authorities are working on that. Let's hope the best, which I think it will happen. And I think we have to do this kind of events. We have to do more research on the field. We have to advance in right recognitions and in the promotion of indigenous communities all around the world so that we can get better protection of those indigenous communities. Second, the second question I received was about the recognition and the categorization of indigenous communities in my country, and this undoubtedly raises many questions, and some of the scholars are very reluctant to the fact that the recognition of those communities as such in the constitutional system may bring some problems towards the whole all the functioning of the state system. But in my opinion, I think this recognition has a lot to do with a historical past that we have to bring through. For example, in Bolivia, we recognize 36 not only indigenous community but nations, and I think this is very important because we are not losing any identity of indigenous community, but we are promoting the identity of them, and we have another mission as a state that is the promoting the interculturality. And that interculturality is a dialogue between cultures that brings a broader sense of a peaceful dialogue within a territory. And that, I think, is not making us more weak, but is making us stronger. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the questions. And the first one, of course, we are working in alternative ways in order to cooperate with other countries and to start building a different framework for not just for commercial means or trade or integration, but really in order to build a new world order, which is something that it won't be done from one day to another. It will take quite a long time. But if you see my region, I mean Latin America and the Caribbean, there are already efforts on that direction. The fact that the OAS is reducing its power is a good sign. That means that entities like UNASUR, which Nestor was Secretary General, as you know, Nestor Kirchner, or CELAC are a good sign, you know. Also, and that's that also it won't work from one day to another. It takes a lot of time, and there are many things that we need to solve. For instance, just to give you an example, since 2007, 2008, up to now, the OAS hasn't really been involved in any conflict resolution in Latin America. The conflicts in Bolivia were solved through the help of UNASUR, who is now doing the mediation, working with the mediators in Venezuela, is UNASUR as well. If you go to Colombia, CELAC is much, much more involved than the OAS in the peace accords, with peace agreements in Colombia and so on. So that's a good sign. The other one is, of course, to try to work with different other networks like BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Let's see what happens after, once the oil prices are stabilized. There are some other efforts. Right now, there's a meeting between CELAC and Russia. It's working right now during these days. Also, there were meetings between CELAC and China. It's another way to try to avoid this relationship between the center and the periphery, you know, which is very, which was very common. So it's a long way to go. And of course, in the case of my country, we are trying to put all our efforts in order to reinforce those kind of endeavors. The second question was regarding prior consent. I think if there's a country that has done more regarding this issue, it's Bolivia, because we are right now trying to change our production matrix, and it takes of course time. It takes of course time to do that, but meanwhile, that's been done with the consent of the indigenous communities. We are exploiting gas. That's our main export, and we are doing that successfully because that's that economic base is helping us in order to try to diversify our economy. We had some problems, of course. Sergio is completely right. I mean, we do have challenges, and in that area in particular, we had a problem. A consultation was made, and regarding the road, and 2/3 of the communities agreed to have a road. The thing is, who are you going to consult? Indigenous peoples, of course, but when you have some foreign countries involved or trying to use that issue for political purposes, or you have NGOs financing process of destabilization against the country, then it becomes more difficult. So of course that's a right, not just that comes from the ILO, but also our constitution is one of the strongest ones regarding, of course, indigenous rights. The last one, I want to be, I'll try to be brief. I think you answer your own question in a way, because of course this, I mean, once you solve a problem, and even Marx talks about this, then new problems will arise. And that's what happens. When you solve this issue, which is trying for Bolivia, I mean, you can imagine my country with, according to the last census, is about half of the population recognize itself as indigenous. You know, trying to look at its own mirror, trying to recognize itself, you know, with all these many nations. One of the ways in which we recognize ourselves was through the denomination of a plurinational state. But that's a picture that was taken in 2009. Maybe in 2020 or in 2030 or 40, we will need to take another picture of the country and to see how we look at ourselves. right now, the best way we found is to recognize ourselves as a plurinational state, because as Sergio was pointing out very clearly, there are at least 36 nations in my country, 36, with different languages, different cultures, different backgrounds, different identity. But it happens that they are in the same, in what's called, what's now called Bolivia. There wasn't any Bolivia 200 years ago, you know, and there wasn't a Audiencia de Charcas 500 years ago. So those things change, as you said, are fluid. Let me tell you a personal example. When I was in school, I've never learned an indigenous language. Never. You know, and I'm ashamed to say that I don't speak an indigenous language. You know, but right now, through the constitution and the work of the government, now indigenous languages have been taught in the schools. So the next generation of Bolivians will speak at least three languages. That's our purpose. They will speak Spanish, which is the language that's common to all of us in this plurinational state. They will speak the language, the indigenous language that's more used in their regions. And they will speak a foreign language, maybe English, maybe Chinese, maybe Russian, I don't know. You know, but the next generation will do that. So they that's the purpose of our plurinationality. And right now, that's an issue that's even being discussed in Spain. If you follow up what's happening in Spain, many political forces are talking about the need of Spain to recognize itself as also a plurinational state. But you said it better than I can, I think, that it's a fluid thing, that constitutions have to adapt to reality. And let's see what the reality of my country will be in 50 years or in 100 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Isabella?
Thank you very much. I really like the word you used to name the problem, that it's a crisis, because it's not a feminist crisis, but a gender-based violence crisis. And that's true, because we look at every day at the news and in every context. And also we have to have a reflection about that we don't need that this problem is seemed for millions of people, but if it is the situation of a population or a group and a small group, it's a problem already. It hasn't to be the majority. But in this case, we have that the majority, we are facing the problem, the gender-based violence problem. But I have to explain that the limitations of the research or the focusing on Mexico City's case is because of research limitations. It's a technical limitation, not because we didn't, or I didn't recognize that it is a national or an international problem indeed. It's to only for technical purposes and research purposes. But what I can realize right now is that this analysis can be applied to any other context. It's like when you multiply any number by zero, you will have zero in every case. And this is the hypothesis that I have right now, that if we apply this analysis into other contexts, cities, countries, or wherever we can apply it, we'll have the same result with some difference maybe, because the problem it is not named as this. I think that we have seen violence since other perspectives that are very interesting, have many positive results and all that. But I think that it's not enough, that we have to name the problem since another perspective that can complement those that are existing. So I think that it can be a good way to start the reflection on gender-based violence problems, and also in general violence problems, social violence, however we know violence in general, to think what can we do through public interventions, because if we stay only in the theoretical scope and only naming it in the academy or in the social work and all that, that's very important, but we have to do something since the public sphere also. So that's the reason. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's great. Are there any other questions? Anybody want to make a point? Yes?
In other words, the breakdown of the economy is affecting a lot of these nations, social environments. And the same thing with the indigenous population, because you look at the attacks on the immigration population, and all this is happening more now with regards to the economic breakdown. Are you both looking into some of that in terms of your country or internationally?
Okay. Great. Are there any other questions? Okay, maybe you want to respond to that?
Well, I would like to propose indeed that analysis that every problem we have in the economic sphere, in the social sphere, in every sphere, I could say, can be analyzed since gender perspective, because as I said, masculinities is about power. It's about many elements that originates the oppression, subordination, control, and that are the main problems that we face in every society. So that's a proposal that we start to analyzing that context, the economical context, for example, where I think is that it's an expression of gender construction, because if we think about masculinities, it's about having power through, for example, money, through capital, through capitalism, through neoliberalism. So this is another, this is only a field in which gender construction is expressed. So we have, that money and capital and every economic element have more value than people in our worlds, have more value than environment, more value than social justice and all that. So if we start to consider that gender elements are one factor that we have to change to have a better societies in terms of well-being, in terms of social justice, maybe we can consider alternatives to solve those problems. That's what I'm proposing.
Thank you. Great. So I want to just invite you to join with me to thank our speakers. I think there were some wonderful presentations and some good questions and some good answers. So I'd just like to thank all of you.